Hello and welcome back. Today we continue our discussion on the European labour mobility policy with an emphasis on residents' rights and the posting of workers. Today is our last video on the need to improve these policies. Do we need to redesign the residence or posting policies and more general European policy making? What are the weak elements of these policies and how can they be improved? Do we need changes in the organization of European policy making or propose a decentralization of policy making power? I want to welcome our local experts, which you already met in the previous video. Welcome to Marcia Zwart of the Dutch Labour Union FNV in the Netherlands. Petru Dandea of the Romanian Labour Union, Cartel Alpha, in Bucharest, Romania. And Anthony Falke from the University of Kent in the UK and Vesalius College in Brussels, Belgium. Let's start. How can the residence policy be improved? What are the weaknesses which should be addressed?
I think that the residence directive could be improved in a number of ways. The first one would be to change the form of the legal instrument that's been chosen for this policy. As you know, a directive is not directly applicable. It is supposed to be given effect in the national legal system by the member state through the adoption of legislation and other legally binding measures. And it's this process of transposition and implementation which has led to problems in practice. If the residence directive could be recast into a regulation, of course, that becomes a directly applicable instrument. It no longer needs to be the subject of an implementing law or regulations at the national level. And the regulation has the same effect as a national law and a regulation, of course, that comes into conflict with national law because under the principle of the supremacy of European law, the regulation is supposed to take precedence over any conflicting provisions of national law. So recasting the residence directive into a residence regulation would, in my mind, enable citizens to make more effective use of the rights of free movement in the EU. So that's one way of making a change to the residence directive to enhance its effectiveness. Another way, of course, would be to look at the enforcement. The Commission is tasked as guardian of the treaty with the monitoring the application of European law. And one of the things the Commission does is to look at how the residence directive has been implemented by the member states. But unfortunately, the Commission has very limited resources at its disposal to engage in these monitoring efforts. So if we consider that there are 28 member states and roughly 14 million people make use of their free movement rights, and when we know that there are only 12 policy officials in Directorate General for Justice, Unit D3, which is responsible for monitoring the application of the residence directive, we can ask the question, legitimate question, whether 12 policy officials is a significantly sufficient resource to be able to effectively monitor the application of the residence directive in 28 member states. So I think that one way of enhancing also the way that the directive operates is to ensure that the Commission's resources are adequate to be able to engage in effective monitoring and enforcement of the residence rules.
Do we need to change the organization of the policy-making process at European level in order to address some of the weaknesses you explained about the residence directive?
I think that there are a number of things that could be done, particularly in terms of the expert group which the Commission has established. The Commission established an expert group that brings together member states and the Commission as observers, where into a forum that provides the ability for the member states to discuss problems that have arisen with the implementation of the directive. Now, the problem is that this decision-making, this expert group, is not open to outside observers. There are some delays in the ability to get the decisions which are made by the expert group published. So at the moment, the last decision that has been published by the expert group dates back from 2012, and we don't know what has been decided in the last few years. So there's an issue, that first issue of transparency of the decision making. The second aspect is that there's no civil society participation in this expert group, and therefore there's no mechanism for civil society to participate in decisions made by this expert group. At the moment, the only way that civil society can participate in decision-making relating to the residence directive is by formulating complaints to the European Commission about infringements of the directive or sending petitions to the European Parliament. Aside from those two mechanisms, there is no way that civil society is able to participate before problems have arisen in how decisions and policies are made within this expert group. So it would be good for the Commission to think about a mechanism to allow for participation by civil society in how this expert group operate, or create another forum which brings together member states and civil society and the Commission and other EU actors. And then the final problem with this expert group is that sometimes the member states identify priorities which are not necessarily backed up by evidence and statistics. And we know that under the directive there is no obligation on the member states to collate statistics into how the residence rules are applied in practice. So one way to provide for further for strengthening evidence-based policy making would be to either incorporate an obligation on the member states in the directive, or change the regulation that exists on the collection of immigration statistics to require member states to collate detailed statistics on how they apply the residence directive in practice.
Might decentralization of the this policy address some of those problems you are mentioning?
I don't think personally that further decentralization would somehow enhance or improve the way that the residence directive applies. In fact, we've seen that a lot of the problems are caused in countries that have a decentralized approach, because there's inconsistency in how decisions are made. So I think that incorporating further decentralized decision making into how the residence directive would create new problems rather than solve existing problems in how the residence directive is implemented in practice.
Currently, there's a discussion about revising the posting directive. Should the current policy be changed, and in what ways?
It should definitely be changed, because it's not working. It's actually causing quite a disturbance on the European labour market. Not a disturbance for companies, but a disturbance for workers and basically small companies. There's a series of amendments that the ETUC, the European Trade Union Confederation, has issued, which say that posting should never be longer than 6 months. The exception on the workland principle, which is the basis of European legislation, the exception on that, which is posting, should not be longer than 6 months. If you are posted longer than 6 months, you're not posted, you are a worker. You're a worker working abroad, and that means regulations of the workland should just apply to you. That creates balance. I think this is the most important of all the amendments we've made, and we're also trying to get the Commission to get better governance on A1 issuance, on A1 withdrawal, and on minimum wages that apply.
Are those elements in the new Commission proposal?
A few of the elements are, but the most important isn't. The EU proposes to limit posting, so limit the exception on the workland principle to 2 years. As unions, we say that is far too long. 2 years is not a temporary job. Posting for 2 years is basically disturbing the labor market. If you limit the period of posting, the period of exception to 6 months, that is long enough. Most real postings, like I said, the installation guy who goes to Romania to install a motor in a ship, he's not gone for longer than 3 or 4 months. So it should be 6 months maximum. And I'm afraid European Union is not going that far.
So how could the current posting policy, which we have been discussing, be improved according to you?
In our opinion, the draft prepared by DG Employment this year and by Commissioner Tyson can be a good step in improving the actual posting directive. Why? Because if the concept of the universal collective labor agreement will be applicable, it is crystal clear that this speculative, let's say, approach that some companies in Europe have in relationship with the Posting of Workers Directive will diminish. Because, for example, because we talked about the Romanian employees working in the harbor of Rotterdam, if this draft prepared by the Commission will be endorsed by the member states, when the collective labor agreement negotiated by the Dutch unions in the harbor of Rotterdam will be applicable also to Romanian employees, the level of payment they will receive will be much higher, and the competition between workers will diminish in the moment that this collective labor agreement will be, let's say, universal, applicable also to the posted workers working in some place in some different companies.
How does this opinion of you and in your union compares to the other opinions in Romania? Is this, let's say, the new focus of the Romanian government, or does the Romanian government see this slightly differently?
In May, when the Romanian parliament participated to the yellow card procedures, we immediately contacted the Romanian government. And we asked the government directly this question, the prime minister. Are the government of Romania supporting the draft directive prepared by the European Commission or not? And at that time, the government gave us, let's say, not a direct response. They said the documents is quite new. We didn't have the time to consult it, but we are going to do this. But we regret that the Romanian parliament joined this yellow card procedures, because just looking a little bit to the directive, how the draft directive, how it looks on this moment, apparently it's not a question of, let's say, trespassing the providings of the European treaty.
As a labor union, have you been involved with others, of course, in Europe in order to give input on this new proposal?
Yeah, we are participating. We are members. Cartel Alpha is member now for more than 23 years. We are members of the European Trade Union Confederation. We have been in contact with all our colleagues from other confederations in Europe, 72 confederations which are member of the ETUC. And we discussed a lot about this draft directive of the Commission, but what I can tell you is that we are fully supporting, all five Romanian trade union confederations are supporting the directive prepared by the Commission.
And has the Commission been rather receptive to, let's say, the comments you made on in the initial phase of making this draft?
Yeah, we also sent an official letter to the Commissioner Tyson, just to let her know that we are supporting the initiative of the Commission and to convince her that we are pushing the Romanian government to support the initiative of the Commission. And myself, I had the opportunity, being the member of the European Economic and Social Committee, I had the opportunity to discuss directly with the Commissioner Thyssen and to offer to her, let's say, to ensure that we, as trade unions in Romania, we are offering our full support to the initiative prepared by the DG Employment and the European Commission.
Do we need to have a change in the way in which policymaking is organized in Europe? Are unions, for example, sufficiently consulted on these kind of, let's say, issues?
It's a good question. I think unions are sufficiently consulted, but of course, unions, 27 countries, 100 unions differ in opinion. So of course, reaching a consensus, even as union parties or as employer parties in the European Union, is very difficult. What I do see is that the actual practice of posting is not playing a big part in decision making. The people who write regulations and who monitor regulations are very far removed from the actual practice of the regulations they make. Mm-hmm. This is a problem. Of course, as unions, we need to jump in that gap and give the examples. But you see, this is of course the democracy of the European Union. You can see that the basic inhabitant of Europe does not recognize himself in what is happening in Brussels. Yes.
To what extent would decentralization of this policy be a solution? So by giving back, let's say, some of the competence to the member states again?
In our opinion, even this complete decentralization can be a solution, but in a way that accept the national principle. So if the decentralization finally mean that for any posted workers in Europe, the national law applicable to the job place will be enforced, we agree with this concept. But we are afraid that the member states are not in favor of this idea. If they don't like the posting of workers directive, which is far less than this, it's crystal clear they will not agree to, let's say, have a decentralized, completely decentralized policy.
Can decentralization be important for this dossier? The workland principle is very dominant in this field. And we could, of course, reinforce this principle by further decentralize this policy.
That would be a solution. As long as Europe does not have one set of minimum income standards for all inhabitants, for all countries, and one social security standard for all countries, you have to decentralize. And the Posting Workers Directive is basically a breach of the workland principle, and a big breach. It's one of the cancers of Europe at the moment, because labor markets are being destabilized. So yes, going back to the workland principle and decentralizing the monitoring would be a solution. There's also another perspective you could take. You could also say, let's have the workland principle leading and the worklands responsible for basically social security contribution and taxation on all income in the workland. And if there is an A1, if there is a posting situation, let the contributions be redistributed through the government instead of, as is happening now, through employers. In this way, you would take away you would basically take the money and the competition on social security away from the employers. That would be another solution.
Would member states be willing to make that step?
I think quite a few of the Eastern European member states, well, I've been to Romania and I've been to Poland and I hear this, are saying the exportation of our low income, our low labor costs, that is what our country is in the European Union for. We have lost so much by coming into the European Union. We need this benefit.